Welcome to Norwich University, and for those of you that are first time in Mack Hall, welcome to our wonderful new facility here on campus, at kind of our showcase auditorium here. And if you get a chance, please walk through the rest of the building if it's your first time here. It is a wonderful facility for our students and the learning education of our Norwich student body. So I want to welcome you to the culminating event of our Norwich STEAM Symposium with the theme Health and Humans, Shaping the Environment, Treating Disease, Changing Culture Through Science, Technology, and Communication. STEAM is an integration of arts and humanities into STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Norwich is celebrating its year of distinction, the final year of our bicentennial countdown, before embarking on a third century. The principles of experiential and interdisciplinary teaching and learning are vital to the success of graduates in a global society. STEAM inherently shares these principles and calls us to action to promote discovery and entrepreneurship through the STEAM disciplines. Tonight, we welcome Sam Kass as the Fall 2018 Todd Lecturer. The Todd Lecture Series is named in honor of retired U.S. Army Major General and Norwich President Emeritus W. Russell Todd, class of 1950, and his late wife Carol, in gratitude for their dedicated service to Norwich University and the Northfield community. The series is generously funded by the generosity of Ellen and John Drew, the Todd's daughter and son-in-law, and the Drew Foundation. The series aspires to serve not only Norwich University campus community, but also residents of Vermont and beyond. It will always be free and open to the public. This lecture tonight is being streamed live to Norwich online students, graduate students, alumni, friends, and family across the globe. We welcome the members of the Todd and Drew families and other supporters of this great program who could not join us in person, but are tuning in. I also want to recognize President Richard Snyder, Provost Dean of, and the Dean of Faculty, and the Chairman of the Todd Lecture Series Committee, Sandra Affinito, Chairman of the Board of Fellows, John Allen, and other distinguished members of the Todd Lecture Series Committee in attendance here tonight. To the Norwich students in attendance or listening online, have you been inspired by the talks or maybe the visits in your classroom today? Think about the big questions, the ideas these talks have sparked in you, the opportunities to explore further. Norwich University's undergraduate research program provides support for students across all disciplines to pursue research and creative work in a collaborative and nurturing environment. Consider taking the next step and bring your ideas to the Students to Scholars Symposium. Applications are due on Monday, November 5th. Email or connect with Professor Amy Woodbury Tees to apply. Remember, innovation starts with an idea. Sam, I invite you to the stage. So in 2009, a newly elected President Obama asked Sam Kass to move from Chicago to the White House and continue his work as personal chef to the First Family. Kass remained personal chef to the First Family until January of 2015. During his tenure inside the White House, Kass took on several additional initiatives, including roles as executive director of First Lady Michelle Obama's Let's Move campaign and senior White House policy advisor for nutrition policy. In these capacities, Kass led the First Lady's work to help America raise a healthier generation of kids and ensure that kids have the opportunity for long, healthy lives they deserve. As senior policy advisor on nutrition, he also advised food and nutrition beyond Let's Move. One of the First Lady's longest serving advisors, Kass helped the First Lady create the first major vegetable garden at the White House in Eleanor Roosevelt's Victory Garden. To date, the garden has yielded thousands of pounds of produce that has been used to feed event guests, staff, and the First Family at the White House, with further harvest donated to local food shelters. Kass is a native of Chicago, a college athlete, played baseball for the University of Chicago, and graduated with a degree in U.S. history. He worked at 312 and AVVEC in Chicago, and was trained as a chef by one of Austria's great chefs in Vienna. In 2011, Fast Company named Kass to their list of 100 most creative people, and in 2012, Kass was named to the inaugural class of chefs in the American Chef Corps, which is dedicated to promoting diplomacy through culinary initiatives. In 2015, Kass joins NBC News as a senior food analyst, where he reports on topics from healthy eating and wellness to emerging food trends and policy. He is founder of Trove, a company working to transform the health and sustainability of the food system. Kass is also an MIT Media Lab Fellow. And tonight he's going to speak a little bit about his book, Eat a Little Better, Great Flavor, Good Health, Better World. Introduce Sam Kass.
Thank you so much. I guess I couldn't have asked for better promotion than that. Move this up a little. Can you guys hear me okay? How is everybody? Good. I gotta say, I'm really thrilled to be here, and I've just been spent the day meeting with students and touring around. I just am blown away. I had read, on paper what the university was about, but just had no idea really what I was walking into, and I could not be more impressed by the quality of the people and the students that I've met today. It's just been a great joy. So congratulations for all you guys have accomplished, and just an incredible culture and community here. So I'm going to talk about the intersection of food and health and climate, and some of the things that I think we need to do to get ourselves on a much better path than we are now. We'll talk a little bit about the book, and really the book is about those core themes. And then definitely want to spend a good amount of time with Q&A. I always think that's just much more fun and engaging and interesting. So definitely please get some questions ready. Since I'm no longer in DC, I will actually answer all of the questions that I'm asked. And I still got the sidestep skills, so I can still go around one if it's some that I can't answer. But now I get to say whatever I want. Freedom is wonderful. So, food is one of the great joys of life. Certainly one of the great joys of my life and my wife's life. So we spend a lot of our waking hours deciding what we're gonna eat next and how we should cook, where we should go out. And while flavor and enjoyment drive a lot of those sort of on the top of our minds, in the end, it's essential that we remember the number one reason we eat fundamentally is to nourish ourselves. And as we talk about the issues that we're facing and the issues that surround how we ultimately get food into our bodies, we should do it remembering a few core facts around what the current conditions are. So food is the number one cause of preventable death and disease in our country, by far. There was a landmark study out of the University of Washington which showed that poor diet is the leading cause of disease burden in the United States, greater than smoking. And dietary risks are costing the United States 9.7 million years of healthy life per year. And annually, it translates into about 678,000 deaths per year. About 1 in 4 deaths in the United States are attributed to what we're eating. That's insane and extraordinary. Obesity alone accounts for about 20% of this nation's healthcare expenditure. And right now, the future actually doesn't look better. We have 1 in 3 of our youngest kids are on track to have diabetes in our lifetime. 1 in 3. And currently, there's 115 million pre-diabetics and diabetics in the United States. 115 million. The effect that this is already having but will have in the future on our healthcare system, on our children's ability to learn, on our economy, and even for our national security interests is more than it's actually possible to comprehend. In fact, very early on when we got to the White House and we were starting to have conversations with key experts and stakeholder groups as we prepared to launch Let's Move, the meeting that actually stood out to me more clearly than any other one was I met with a group of retired 3- and 4-star generals who sought us out to say that they believed that obesity was the nation's greatest national security risk and that our ability to put an effective force into theater was really at risk. Obesity is the number one cause of disqualification for military service. 27% of 17 through 24-year-olds aren't able to serve in the military because of obesity. And the Army had to institute a pre-boot camp for boot camp for a whole other cadre who otherwise would not have made it through. This is hard to comprehend just how deep these problems are plaguing us. It's fundamentally, you know, unsustainable. We can't continue down this path. And ultimately, I think, you know, as the pressure mounts on businesses and certainly on the government, because ultimately a lot of these folks are going to end up on government roles, governments are going to get more and more aggressive in trying to tackle this. And this is an issue that's not just happening here. It's starting to happen globally. At the same time, food and agriculture is a major driver of climate change. It's the number two source of greenhouse gas emissions globally. But unlike energy, when you look at the curve is going like this in terms of emissions. Whereas energy, we've invested for years and years around other alternative solutions and possibilities to make progress on our emissions. And we can see a future where the curve flattens out and actually starts to go down. Food and agriculture, it's going straight up. And so experts predict in about 20 years or so will be the number one driver of greenhouse gas emissions. But food is also on the front lines of the impact of climate. So I know we are a very fit, healthy culture here, but who here likes, say, wine? Come on, I know more of you back there like wine. It's okay, I know you're not supposed to drink here, but when you're gone, you're gonna have a glass of wine. Who here had coffee this morning? How about chocolate? Any chocolate lovers? Come on, I know you guys like chocolate more than that. lobster, shrimp, shellfish, anybody? Yeah, me too. So experts predict that our kids and grandkids will not be able to eat those products. And a whole host of other ones, like nuts of various kinds. Because with a volatile climate, those products are going to be very hard to grow. It's not that they will be totally gone, but they will be so expensive, you'll see coffee or wine be priced more like caviar. And in fact, in England, in Champagne, Champagne growers are buying land in England because they don't think in the next 10 or 15 years they're going to be able to produce a consistent supply of champagne in Champagne. So we think about these issues as if they're happening at some point in the future. They're happening now. And we have to start understanding that we are in the middle of this in this very moment. At the same time, we also waste about a third of what we produce globally, 40% in the United States. We waste 40% of the food we produce, all the fuel and water and soil and all the energy that it goes into to take that food from the ground, process it, and get it to us is being thrown away. And if you actually totaled up food waste globally, it would be the third largest greenhouse gas emitter if it were a country after China and the United States. Because all that food goes into landfill and produces methane, which is a highly intense greenhouse gas. So there's a great irony of the food system itself is going to make it increasingly difficult to grow food. And all the while we're doing this, while we are depleting at just devastating rates, water and soil resources, which is literally the foundation of our very existence. So when you start putting all these pieces together, I know like I'm starting you guys off on a pretty downer. You're like, oh man, this is terrible. we'll lift up a little bit, don't worry. But it is pretty intense when you start thinking about these two forces that are shaping our food system and the world that we will be able to, that we are handing down to our kids. But these are the two things that are gonna shape, I think, what the next 10, 20, 30 years are gonna look like when it comes to how we feed ourselves. And it adds a lot of complexity when you're trying to juggle human health and environmental health, but it also creates some real opportunity for us. And that convergence of these two key fundamental threats to our well-being are giving us opportunity. Because when you look at what a healthiest diet is, and when you look at what the most sustainable diet is, they're deeply correlated. And in fact, there is tremendous overlap. In the end, we have to, the fundamental answer is we have to start eating a much more plant-based diet. And I say that as a lover of steak, okay? I am not a vegetarian or vegan. All the power to them. But we have to move down, down the line from the bigger animals to the smaller animals and really to a plant-based diet. When you look at what drives emissions, beef, for example, is by far and away the biggest driver of greenhouse gas emissions. Beef for consumption. Dairy is less. Still has a pretty big footprint, but nothing like beef. When you look at broccoli, lentils, they don't really show up in terms of their carbon footprint. But at the same time, you know, beans are like the healthiest thing you can eat, really good for the soil, and very literally no impact on emissions. So that creates an opportunity for us to start solving some of these challenges, both sides of this coin, if we figure out how do we make a more plant-based diet cool and accessible for everybody. And so that's what we need to talk about. So how do we approach this transition? Like, what is it we need to do? How do we get from where we are today to where it's very clear we need to go and actually need to go pretty, you know, relatively quickly? So at the root of this question is really our culture. You know, the question we have to ask is, what are the values that we're basing our decisions on? What do we really care about? And in this country, you know, one of our values is big portion sizes. We love a big plate. It's part of how we understand value when it comes to food. It's not served us that well. But that we have to start thinking about, okay, what are the values we're looking for and supporting in the choices we're making in food as it pertains to the challenge that we face? And food is so many things to us when we try to parse out what our values really are. It's one of the deepest expressions of our culture and our very identity. It's how we identify who we are. It's how we identify who we're not. It's how we show each other love. For so many people, it's a job. There's over a billion people working on the agricultural side around the world. It's how we celebrate. It's how we mourn. It's how we deal with stress. We even get very superstitious about food, which I had never fully appreciated. Let me tell a quick side story here. I never fully appreciated sort of the relationship of stress and sort of superstition until I cooked my only meal on Air Force One. And it was in the second presidential campaign. And we were flying to the second debate. So the way that it would work is you'd have 3 days of sort of debate prep, and then you'd somewhere isolated. Those were long days. poor guy. And then we'd fly to wherever the debate was, and you'd get ready, and away he went. And so we got on the plane, and we were flying kind of a little bit of an early time, so I didn't know for lunch, didn't know whether we wanted to eat or not. So I popped my head in, and I said, you know, can I get you some? You're hungry? He's like, I don't know. Yeah, you know, sure, yeah, whatever you want. So I go back into Air Force One kitchen, which is, you know, not surprisingly, very small. And when somebody's cooking the president's meal, like, everybody stops and, like, clears out. So, like, I walked in and they just, like, ran away. I was like, wait, come on, hang out. It'd be fun. That was not protocol. It's like, everybody get out of that person's way. And so I cooked him a penne pasta with grilled chicken, pesto, spinach, and a little Parmesan cheese, and sort of what I had kind of ready for him. And so I go back, I bring it to him, he's playing cards, and everybody's like trying to play it cool. Everybody's trying to be relaxed. If you remember, Romney had won the first debate. Now, if you asked him, he would disagree with you. But everybody said Romney had won the first debate. And the pundits were saying that, you know, if Obama loses the second debate, it's over for him. Romney's was definitely increasing in the polls, and they said, you know, he's one debate away, he's going to lose the election. So we were all trying to play it really cool, and just pretend like everything was fine. And I think he was trying to set the tone for everybody, so he was like extra relaxed, but everybody was stressed. You could just feel it, like we were all so stressed out. And so I bring in this pasta, and I go back, they're playing cards and hanging out, and so I go back, I clean up, I come back in, and he was like, man, you know when you didn't know what you want, but then you get it and you realize that's exactly what you want? This is this pasta. And I was like, it's even more funny because like that's just not him. Like he doesn't say those kind of, like the best you'd get from him if he liked your dish would be like, hey man, that was solid. Like that was solid, tasty. Like then you were like, yes, like killed that, you know? But not that he, so he just goes on and on about this pasta. So I come back in, ask him, you know, so I come back, check everything. Man, just again, that pasta was so perfect. And I was like, okay, this is getting really weird. And so we land, he goes off, he's getting ready to go on stage, and I get an email from Pete, the photographer. He's like, hey man, I don't know what you put in that pasta, but he's still talking about this pasta. I was like, okay, this is so strange. And so after the debate, I emailed him and said, you know, debates were not his favorite. So you said, you know, he did very well that night, definitely won that debate and sort of, you know, cruised ahead. And so I emailed him and I said, you know, hey man, you did great. That was amazing. You only got one more left, like you're almost there. And he wrote back, it was the pasta. And so from that point on, what do you think we ate the last debate? What do you think we had on election? So election night, we ate the same thing that I'd cooked for them that election night, except I had to add this random pasta, which didn't work with the menu, but we just had to have it. So ever since it became the lucky pasta and took on this bigger importance in our lives in a way that's, you know, strange. So food, it's just to say that food plays a lot of different roles in how we eat. And how we understand ourselves and how we deal with our lives in so many different ways. And so when you think about change, we have to take all that into consideration. And being the sort of senior advisor to the president on nutrition policy, you know, I can tell you that policy and politics definitely have a role to play. And I'll talk about that in a minute. But overcoming these challenges is much deeper and more profound than just passing some piece of legislation or getting some regulation out of Health and Human Services. We have to understand and dig into who we are as people. And we have to look at, I think, three key steps that are critical if we're gonna really make progress. So one, the healthy and sustainable choice must be the easier choice. It must be easy. If we want us people to make different changes, then we have to make it much easier on themselves. Because in the end, and we'll talk about this some more, we eat what we see. We eat what we surround ourselves with. It must be affordable and attainable. And we have to create a culture that values and inspires us to make these choices. And so no company, people say, well, what's the playbook? Who's done this well? I actually say Coca-Cola is probably the model that we need to emulate, ironically, I know. I know there's a lot of irony in that. But Coke has built their entire business and one of the most successful companies in human history on the simple phrase within an arm's reach of desire. So their whole strategy was surround people with Coca-Cola, make it incredibly accessible. So it's there, it's there, and there. And then inspire people to want to buy it through marketing. We'll talk more about marketing in a minute. But that's our roadmap. How do we surround people with better choices? And how do we inspire them to make those choices? I really started learning this when I started cooking for the Obamas back in Chicago. It was then Senator Obama and Michelle, and the girls were really young. He had launched his campaign, and it was just grandma. Like, they didn't have any kind of staff. And so she brought me in to help, just help her out some, because she was starting to travel a lot more too. And intuitively what I did which I only came to realize later when I got into the White House, the science that was actually behind this. But intuitively, I started to, we did an overhaul, and I made the girls lead it. So if they couldn't pronounce most of what was in it, or sugar was number one or two when it wasn't supposed to be as an ingredient, in the bag it went. If you ever just want some entertainment, you should do that, because it was really funny. They're like, no, not the mac and cheese, no. But we went through and sort of cleaned out the things that were the least healthy, and then put the treats that, you know, everybody needs some treats, cookies are great, but you have to put those out of sight, and put them where they couldn't, where you couldn't see it. And then I would take the fruit that was in the bottom bin. How many people have thrown out bins full of fruit or vegetables in that bottom bin? Come on, me, I have, I know. Look at everybody going like this, short arming the hand. Yes, we've all done that. Because we don't see it, it sits down there, we forget about it. So I took all those out and put it on the counter, put the grapes and the apples on the counter, put nuts in clear jars where everybody could see it. And so instead of running by and grabbing the handful of chips, they ran by and grabbed a handful of grapes because they just wanted a snack. They weren't that concerned about it. So how do we set our environments up is critical, and I think we all have a role to play in this. So whether it's in, you know, our schools or our classes or our jobs, or the city, or wherever it is we work outside of our home, we start with our home, but I think we also have a role to say, what is the environment around us that is shaping our choices, and how do we make an effort to make the healthier choices within arm's reach? And it turns out, when you start looking at the behavioral economics of it, that's exactly how it works. The reason why companies pay a ton of money to have the end cap is because you're more likely to buy it because you're passing in front of that more often. The reason why the shelf that's cost the most money is at eye level is because that's what you see more often, and that's where the sales are the greatest. The reason why the sugary kid cereal is on the bottom, because that's like where that little kid is. And that little cartoon staring him right in the face, which is terrible, but it's true, and it works. So I think we have a responsibility to try to push on this in every environment that we live in and operate in, and try to make ourselves, to those environments in our community, more affordable. I mean, more healthy environments. But as we improve these environments, we also have to inspire our kids and families to make these choices. And so right now, kids are seeing 5,500 ads for junk food a year, average child. 5,500 ads, and how many for fruits, vegetables, and water, would you say? 100. And we have to do a much better job at figuring out, how do we market this way of life? How do we inspire people to want to make these choices? And part of our problem is that from the health side, we try to educate everybody around what they should be doing. So we say to everybody, broccoli is really good for you. It's high in fiber and B12 and all the various folic acid. And Coke is saying open happiness. And McDonald's is saying, like, I'm loving it. And, you know, all marketing that's most effective is around love, happiness, get the sexy lady or the sexy man. And love, sex, and happiness beats fiber and vitamin B, like, every single time. So we have to do a much better job at telling stories that connect emotionally with people, so that, particularly for young people, start aspiring to want to live like this and make choices that are going to be good for them and good for the planet. And we did a lot of work on this in the White House. We did a big water campaign with partners out in the world, big branding and marketing firms. We asked them, I said, whatever Coke and McDonald's gets, I want. So we had a bunch of partners put together this campaign, and the sophistication by which they know how to trigger our thoughts and our I mean, they test our brains to see how you what kinds of responses you get when you see a commercial. And if you can trigger a emotional response where that part of your brain lights up and a memory response, so that triggers something in you and it makes you hearken back to something in your past, that is the combination that's most likely going to get you to make a different choice. So that's what they're all going for. And they have huge centers set up to scan your minds to see what their ad campaign is going to do. So these partners of ours, we in the government couldn't do that ourselves, but these partners did, and it came up with a water campaign called Drink Up, You Are What You Drink. And that, even though we've been promoting water for a long time, moved the whole category by over 3%, which Nielsen, who like tracks basically everything we do, had never seen a shift of that magnitude across a category. But it was because we in the health community stopped saying, it's drink 6 glasses a day, you know, you'll be healthy. You start talking about the emotional impact that you can have. We did the same thing with fruits and vegetables, a campaign called F&V. Because right now you have like a pile of apples competing with like LeBron James on like a Gatorade thing, and we're gonna lose that one every time. We need the LeBron marketing for these apples, so we tried to work on that. And I think these are the kinds of things that have led to unprecedented shifts in our culture. And especially among young people, which I saw today, and it gives me so much hope. Sugary beverages are in steep decline. Water now actually, 2 years ago, became the number one consumed beverage again in the United States for the first time in decades. It's kind of crazy that it was not always, but it's true. Restaurants have been overhauling their menus. You know, salad companies are the fastest growing restaurant chain in the United States. That's crazy. They serve salad. This is America. But it's great. I support it. McDonald's is marketing the artisanal chicken sandwich a year or so ago. Now, I still don't know what that is, but it speaks to craft and care and higher quality. And so for McDonald's, who is marketing to the most, you know, everyday consumer, to think that even those folks are looking to, who are eating there day in and day out, want that in their food, it says that we're making a lot of progress. That is not their marketing strategy of a few years ago. White Castle just put the Impossible Burger. You guys know Impossible Burger? The veggie, it's basically a burger made from plant proteins that looks, it's 100%, you should Google it when you leave here. It's 100% plant-based, but it looks just like a burger. It bleeds. It's like pink in the middle. It's crazy. And it tastes actually not bad. I mean, I guess I just showed my true colors right there, didn't I? I'm trying to be supportive of it. But White Castle just put it in all of their restaurants and actually saw, I think it was something like a 25% increase in sales once they put it in those stores. So we're seeing real progress. And in the companies, the big companies, their portfolios that are growing are only in their better for you. Their classic brands that they build their businesses on are flat or in steep decline. And the last 24 months or so, literally every CEO of every major food company has been fired because their portfolios are not performing, because largely they're not meeting the needs of consumers. And consumers are saying, we want something better, we want something different. And that power is starting to transform how we eat. And a lot of this is being driven by young people, and I saw this today. Attitudes and behaviors for 35 and under are fundamentally different on these issues than older folks. And the 20-year-old is way more intense than even my generation, 38. And I saw that today. I mean, the sophistication and the understanding of these issues was just mind-blowing. In fact, I started asking some of the students questions about the things I'm an expert in. but which gives me so much hope and pleasure. But you see in 10 years when the 35-year-old's 45 and the 20-year-old's 30, we're gonna be driving a lot of the decisions that companies are making by demanding and expecting a much higher level of food when it comes to both health and sustainability. So when we put these pieces together, I think we start to see a culture that's starting to build a value system that I think can lead us to where we wanna go. But it's going to be up to us to drive it. Now, on the policy side, just a few words about policy from our time. The first thing I'd say is that if you care about health, you have to care about climate change. No longer can we see these issues as separate. And there's a lot we need to do. Climate should not be a partisan issue. It has become a partisan issue in a way that's really worrisome to me. But Paris, the accord, we need to be in that. We should not be debating sort of the fundamental science that's pretty much universally agreed upon by scientists. What's happened to the EPA for me is quite disturbing. But we have made a ton of progress, and we made a ton of progress when we were there. Things like overhauling school nutrition. So when we got into the White House, there was no standards on what you could sell in schools. You could literally sell anything you wanted. And schools did sell whatever they wanted. So we put standards on what you could sell. We increased the nutritional standards on the lunch program itself and added money for the first time in 30 years. And I think the program I'm most proud of in the schools was the community eligibility program, which was basically a breakfast program that solved this big problem of stigma. So at lunch, all the kids would eat together. But for breakfast, it was only for poor kids. And I learned about this just how bad hunger, well, I'm gonna tell a quick story. I learned about how bad hunger was when I was actually on and how these cafeteria workers were dealing with it when I was on Chopped. Anybody watch Chopped? Okay, good. Great show. Gotta love Chopped, right? And I was a judge. So for those of you who have not watched the Food Network, it's a cooking competition. And I was a judge on one where it had three school chefs compete. And the main course was the secret ingredient. They have a few ingredients they have to figure out in 30 minutes how to make a dish. And she, one of the women named Barbara, made, the ingredient was quinoa. And she made this pasta dish, which was absolutely delicious. It had Italian sausage and rapini, and it was Parmesan cheese. It was really great, except she just kind of threw the raw quinoa in on top. From like a culinary standpoint, it was a total disaster. And you know, they want you to kind of play the judge role where you're just like kind of the mean judge, which I tried to resist. But on this one, it's sort of like I don't understand why you did that. Like, just doesn't make any sense. And she said, and I'll never forget, she said, well, first of all, I don't really know what quinoa is. She was like, look at me, like, what is this stuff? But she was like, but what I do know is that today is Monday, and on Monday, I always cook pasta. And I was like, okay, well, okay. She was like, well, because most of my kids, so many of my kids come to school on Monday having not eaten anything over the weekend. And so I wanna make sure I'm cooking something that they'll eat, something that they'll stick to their ribs, and something that's gonna fill them up. And you start to dig into the numbers and just how many kids in this country, 1 in 5 are food insecure, and how dependent they are on these programs just to get their basic nutrition. And so when you looked at breakfast, even though so many of these kids don't get dinner, they were so worried about being stigmatized as being the poor kids that they wouldn't go have breakfast because only the poor kids got breakfast. And so you had millions of kids across the country, literally, who would go hungry over being labeled as the poor kid. And so this program allows schools that have large populations of low-income kids to just serve breakfast in the classroom for everybody. And when you see the results of this program, they're just transformational. Not only, you know, are kids now full, you see attendance significantly improve, you see behavior improve. Because man, even now, like if I skip a meal like that, like I'm a bad person, you know? Back, you know, ask an 8-year-old who hasn't eaten since lunch the day before to learn. And so of course you see a significant increase in test scores, both math and reading comprehension scores go up significantly. Depending on the pilot, there's a number of them, it's like 15% improvement, 15 to 20% improvement. I don't know any education intervention that instantly has a result, an ROI like that. And so those kind of the policies that can have a big impact. Another one that we're very proud of was WIC, you know, the Women, Infants, and Children's Program. One of the most important programs, I would say, in the country. 1 in 2 kids born in America are on this program. 1 in 2. When we got in there, they didn't serve vegetables. It's a very restrictive program. So SNAP, you can buy basically anything that you need. It's a very little amount of money, but it just helps supplement your nutrition budget. But WIC is very prescriptive for pregnant moms and infants, with infants and then children under 2. But very prescriptive. But you couldn't buy vegetables or fruit. So we changed that, obviously, and added a couple dollars to that program, which for specifically for produce, which was a big deal for people of need. We actually worked with the military to overhaul and update their nutrition standard. Hadn't been done in 20 years. And when you look, the only organization that buys more food than the military is Walmart, just to put it in perspective. It's true. So that was a very big lever that we had to pull, and one that we worked very, very hard on to improve those standards. So we did lots of stuff. We banned trans fats. We updated Nutrition Facts Panel, put added sugars on the label, did menu labeling, where some restaurants now you see, I guess it's mostly around, probably not fully yet. You'll see calorie counts on quick service restaurants. That was something that we worked very hard on. So there's lots of roles. You know, we got a lot done on policy, and policy is important. I would say it's safe to say that there's not a ton happening on health and nutrition currently in the White House. That's okay. The current administration, I gotta say, has not been as aggressive to roll back our work than some other parts of policy that have been put through the Obama administration. But we're definitely not making the progress we need. But I don't see that Congress is going to do very much for the foreseeable future on just about anything. And so I think the game is to be played at the state and local level for those who are engaged on these issues, and which is okay. Because when you go into the chief, so when I would go into the chief of staff's office, like on menu labeling, to try to propose how we wanted to move forward, the first question that the chief of staff asked me was, okay, where has this been done and what happened? So the whole way the government is set up is to allow the states to experiment, to learn, to try passing laws and policies, and then the federal government can learn from that and craft what is a better version of that, hopefully, ideally. And so the work right now is definitely at the state and local level. The other piece is, and I'd say this, is that, and I think it's really exemplified here, and I saw a lot of it today, but there has to be an interdisciplinary approach. And public-private partnerships, but how do we work with different groups, different parts of the system, have been one of the keys to our success. So we work with the YMCA to overhaul afternoon snack, because a lot of times actually what you'd see when you looked at a kid's day, they'd actually do well through breakfast and lunch, and then they get afternoon snack, and it'd be like 2 sodas and a bag of chips, and it's like all your work was undone. So identifying the right partners is something that, you know, we found to be incredibly important in our work, and I think is true in life. The one part that we really, as a community, did not do a good job in is that we were very good at turning our wins into losses. And time, remember I told you about that water? I'll give you one example. Time and time again, we did this. So in that water campaign, I thought we were going to get a bunch of pushback because we were using water. You know, water bottles were a part of it. It was tap water and was part of it, and water bottles were the other. And so I figured the people who were against, you know, bottled water were going to be very critical of us. Instead, we got crushed by the advocates around the fact that we didn't say don't drink soda, even though we had been very much clear in our messaging around soda being a problem. They were wrong on this. But what it ends up doing is it, one, blunts our momentum, and it totally makes it much more difficult for the next time I had to try to do a big initiative, or anybody who steps out to try to push something forward, able to get it done. Literally the quote was, Oh, yeah, so that water thing you tried to do was a big success. Now you want us to do this? So we have to work to understand when people are taking on risks, when organizations, when a school, when a business leader or a politician sticks their neck out and tries to get something done, even if it's not 100% of what we think it needs to be, that we find a way to support progress and you know, push them to keep going. And something that was a big challenge for us in the White House. So I think when we think about the environment, I think we need to see, you know, how do we set ourselves up for success in our communities, and then how do we set ourselves up for success in our homes? And the fundamental principles are the same. But part of our challenge has been that we espouse ourselves, we're told that we have this very utopic vision of what it needs to be. And so a lot of what my book is focusing in on is how do we make ourselves set up for success and focus on the how, not the what. So you have about 80% of the country actively saying that they want to eat a little better. How many here would say that they're trying to eat better? Actively trying. Pretty good. That's a lot. It's about 80%, I think. My numbers are pretty good. How many would you say, raise your hand if you think you're actually doing that, like you're successful in doing that? Yeah, so you guys are overachievers. It's about 80% of the country says they're actively trying to do better, and about 20% report actually being able to do it. And I think the reason is because, one, we're being told that we have to eat healthy, local, organic, sustainable, flaxseed, omega-3, whatever. And the people telling this, by the way, don't really do that themselves. In fact, a guy that I know who wrote a book about being vegan before dinner, you probably figure him out. I went out to lunch with him like 2 months after he wrote that book, and he went and got a pastrami sandwich with like an extra smear of liver. And I was like, really, man, you just came out with that book. It's noon. What are you doing? It's like, so it just drives me crazy. So we're told there's this ideal that we need to reach, which is totally out of touch with the reality of our actual lives. We're told that if you eat this way, you're good, and if you don't eat this way, you're bad. And then people, of course, try, and they fail, and they get discouraged, and they go back to sort of a vicious cycle of failure. So really what the book focuses on, and I think what we need to focus on as a community, both in our homes and our broader communities and our society, is how do we celebrate progress? What are the actual strategies and tools that we can give people to make progress one step at a time? If you eat a Twinkie, I still love you, it's okay. Get back on it and win the next round. And so the book walks through not only like how do you set that up in your home, about eating what you see, because in the end, when you walk into your kitchen and you see those chips and you think to yourself, I want those chips, you don't want them, you just saw them. And so how do we set ourselves up for success there? And then those recipes in there are tools to help us figure out, okay, here's a simple dish that I can make that's actually going to accomplish the goals that, and the values that we're set out to be. So I do have a lot of hope, both within the cultural shift that I see, particularly being young people, the innovations and businesses that are being started by entrepreneurs all over the country are transforming how we're thinking about food and bringing the values around health and sustainability to our businesses and forcing the bigger guys to have to change because they're taking market share. I think we have it in us to start solving these problems. And we have a real moral imperative to do so, especially when we start thinking about what is the society and culture that we want to hand to the next generation and the next generation after that. So I'm going to stop there and we can get into a conversation. But I just want to say I'm very thankful for being here and leave after the conversation, say, with the students, much more hopeful than I was even when I came. So thank you guys so very much.
So thank you. There's two mics down here, so I encourage you, I'm going to reserve the mic over to your right for students and the mic over here to the left for everyone else. And we'll kind of rotate back and forth, so if you have a question, please come forward. And while folks are thinking about questions, I'll throw out the first one.
Go ahead.
So your time in the White House, how did that inform you with your ideas and recipes that you put in your book?
So it informed me that you have to meet people where they are, that everybody's busy and struggling, you know, just to get by, just to try to get make sure their kids get, you know, their homework done and take a bath, and which I now, I have a 15-month-old, so I'm learning that the hard way now. And that, you know, this sort of big vision, you got to overhaul everything, was just nonsense. It's just not how society works, not how people work. And so to try to write a book that was loving and empathetic, and took into account sort of the realities and challenges that people were facing on a daily basis. I will say it was a bit of a struggle because I hadn't been in the recipe mindset for a long time. You know, in the White House, so much of my mental and emotional energy was spent on the policy side that, you know, I would be in a meeting till like 5:30 and realize like, oh my God, I got 20 minutes to get dinner ready for the President of the United States. So I'd like literally start running through the White House. My skills got worse, but I got really fast in getting dinner on the table, which now serves me well. I just think keeping that in mind, but it was an interesting mental place to go back to about how do I think about flavor, how to put together these recipes that I've been cooking for, you know, so many years.
All right, over here.
Good evening, sir. Spoke at lunch earlier, and yes. I didn't get a chance to ask. So you mentioned a little bit about the economic side of the food industry. And I know I come from a low-income family, and I imagine a lot of other students, they do. And in a culture where it costs more to get a bag of apples than a bag of chips, how do you see that? How do you see that problem influencing a lot of the programs that you were trying to put into place?
Yeah, it's a fundamental problem. I'd say it's probably the hardest problem that we face, that we have to tackle. I think it's a couple core answers. One, a lot of people think that, and it's a sort of a common narrative, that the reason why that cheeseburger, for example, is cheaper than a bunch of carrots is because government subsidies are subsidizing the cheeseburger and making it cheaper. The reality is that's actually untrue. What really we've done, it's so neat and nice, but I wish it were true because that's actually quite easy to solve. What's actually happened is that for decades we have invested in innovation around the basic ingredients of that cheeseburger, corn and soy, and we figured out how to grow it incredibly efficiently. So we can grow it, I mean, in a way that's almost a miracle when you actually look at sort of the arc of agricultural history. And so we've invested hundreds and hundreds of billions of dollars into those crops. I know this is the big systemic problem that we face. By comparison, the nutrient-dense foods like apples and carrots and spinach and things, statistically, we've invested $0 as compared to corn and soy. Statistically insignificant amount of resources have gone into figuring out how to grow the crops that we need to eat in a much more efficient and affordable manner. So part of what we do is like not that exciting, but one of the things we need to do that would have the biggest impact, in my opinion, is invest a ton more money in research around how do we grow and innovate around nutrient-dense foods. We have to figure out how to do that if we want to bring the cost down, certainly as compared to the cheeseburgers. That's starting to happen. Technology is actually, we're starting to do some really interesting stuff that I think could have a big impact there. In the interim, I think we need to invest in new models that deliver nutritious foods to low-income communities. So this was just a few years ago, we actually invested a ton of money, like in tax breaks and grants and stuff, hundreds of millions of dollars into incentivizing grocery stores to go into low-income communities. But it's expensive to build brick and mortar. But you're now seeing delivery models, trucks that come in that will be in a different part of the community on a different day, much lighter footprint models that are delivering really nutrient-dense offerings. Ugly, you know, produce that's super good, but like the carrot's a little curved, right now gets thrown out. I think those offer a pretty good opportunity to get much more affordable produce into communities that need it. And honestly, the last key part of the answer is cooking. So big challenge for us is that a lot of people don't cook anymore. And in low-income communities, it's tough because a lot of people work in 2-3 jobs. There's not a lot of time. But the best way to eat healthy in an affordable way is to cook. And I can produce delicious food that feeds a family of four for just a couple bucks. We need those skills and knowledge base and the place to cook. But I think that's going to be another key part of how do we empower people with the information about what are recipes that are very affordable but nutrient dense to at least a couple times a week get a much better meal into the mouths of those families. So that's the three parts that I think are going to be critical to cracking that nut. But it's a very challenging problem.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening, sir. This might seem like a simple question, but it's one that I've always wondered. If you were a college student, like a lot of us here are,
yeah.
What's the one food, being that you, if you ate in the cafeteria like most of us do, what's the one food that you would drop or group of foods that you would steer away from as a student?
Interesting question. Now I feel like, you know, I'm going to fall into the cliches like, man, it's been so long since I've been in college. Look, I think like, I don't know what you're doing now, so it's hard for me to answer that question specifically. What I do in my life, which is probably applicable, like I never drink sugary drinks ever. Okay, I have a gin and tonic from time to time. I don't know if that counts. But besides that, but never in your dorm, guys. I heard what happens if you do that in the dorm. Don't do that. Yes, don't do that. You'll be marching up and down for days and days. So I would make sure you're drinking as much water as you possibly can, and like don't take in any sugar from a liquid form. I don't eat dessert, really. My wife would laugh at me if she heard me say this to you guys. I like ice cream, I just don't eat it very often. Like if I'm out or if I'm in a cafeteria, I would never ever have dessert. Those are just empty calories that aren't helping you at all. And the calorie load from that is like, you know, you can go 400, 500, 600 calories like that. You don't even realize it. I think the guidance that we came up with, you know, for my plate, the new food pyramid that we came up with, was basically try to have half that plate be fruits and vegetables. I think it's a pretty good guideline. Another quarter be a whole grain, and then you have your protein. If you try to get in that basic ballpark most days, then you don't have to worry about the rest of the things that you're doing. That would be my advice to you. What do you think you should drop?
I eat a lot of Nutella. I should probably not do that. But,
that might be a logical place to start. I don't know. I don't know what you think.
Good evening, sir.
How are you, sir?
I have a question regarding the agriculture that you are referencing. So you directly stated that a more plant-based diet is what's needed, and I think that's like obviously we need to move that way. But you also stated that agriculture is one of the largest contributors to greenhouse gases. Mm-hmm. So in an effort to push towards more of a plant-based diet that pushes more responsibility and more productivity onto the farmer. Mm-hmm. I come from a really rural background, yep. So putting more pressure on the small farmer to produce more greens and more plants, yep, for just the country as a whole,
yep,
would force us to use things like pesticides and fertilizers,
yep. Yep.
And a more abundance than we already do. And by doing that, you're basically promoting the petroleum industry. So it's kind of like a twofold there,
yep,
where you want the production as well as the nutrition for the country. But I'm just wondering, I know you're not in the White House anymore, but any policy that you know of that could be going through to kind of combat that part of it?
Yeah, so it's a great question. I would say, but I'm not sure I fully agree with the premise. The part that right now we're growing mostly corn and soy in this country, acreage-wise, by far and away the top two crops, and we're putting a ton of petroleum-based products on that land. In fact, the very plants themselves are designed explicitly to be resistant to pesticides and to soak up a ton of, you know, petroleum-based nitrogen. So that's ongoing. Now, how do we have at scale more efficiencies in other crops that we have not invested in to grow as efficiently? That, I think, and that's where the research point comes in, that I think is absolutely critical. But right now, we're growing all these grains and feeding them to cows, and the conversion, your best estimate on conversion there is about 20 calories of energy to produce 1 calorie of beef, just as an example, is wildly inefficient. Whereas you could grow 1 energy of bean, and it takes about two calories of energy to do 1 calorie of bean, and I'm eating it. So just from an efficiency standpoint, there's a lot to be gained by growing food that we'll directly consume. There's no question that for farmers who've invested a ton of money in the infrastructure to farm in the current way that so many are, that's a real challenge to make those kind of changes. And so policies around how do you help incentivize transition and into growing new things or growing in different with different methods. So, you know, there are a lot of farmers, to the petroleum question, there's a lot of farmers who are trying from a, my answer on the policy one would be, there's a lot of farmers who are trying to transition to organic, but that takes 3 years. And in that transition, you don't get the price premium. So you have to incur all the cost, but you don't get any premium. And it's a huge barrier for farmers who want to use less of these chemicals to actually being able to do it. So one very good area where a very clear policy would be is to support farmers through transition to organic, whether they're whatever they're growing. And there's been some work on there, and there's some talk about some good stuff in the current farm bill that's being negotiated to do that. So that's a very clear policy. But I think we have to give farmers better crops, better seeds, better tools, better supports for the crop, the crops that are going to support the well-being of this country, and that should be the foundation of our policy. So right now, the irony of our government is that on HHS is saying you should eat this, and our agricultural system is supporting a completely different diet, and we have to start bringing those two sets of recommendations together. So there's no, there's no one drop easy answer here. Mm-hmm. But as you start to see demand for beef consumption go down, you're going to start to see farmers starting to figure out, you know, where what else they need to be growing. The problem is, the challenge for the world is that consumption in other countries is going straight up. So whether we're eating it here or somewhere else, the impact on the climate is the same. Like, we're all connected. And so part of the challenge is, like, this is increasingly a global problem. That's going to be hard to solve because you're going to have to see a global cultural shift on meat consumption, which is, you know, it's a pretty daunting thing to even say, let alone try to figure out how you do it. But I appreciate the I almost all agree with you in the sense of the pressures and how this then flows down to the farmers and the challenge. Where are you from?
I'm from like Southeast Indiana.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah.
Yeah, nothing but corn and soy down there.
No, sir.
Yeah. As far as the eye can see. Is that, you know, an imperfect answer to a very difficult question, I hope?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, let's thank Sam Kass one more time.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.